Welcome back to the Accor Hotels Arena here in spectacular Paris, where game one went the way of the LPL champions. Now, important to note that during quarterfinals and semifinals in the last 3 weeks, the team that won the first game went on to win the entire series.
Congratulations!
Way. This is a bad sign for G2 Esports, Papa Smitty.
But it's such a different animal to face G2 Esports on the blue side. I actually think that's the most terrorizing proposition for any coach, maybe in history, given how flexible they are to send just about anything into Perks' hands in the bot lane.
Exactly, because the red side has to ban Pantheon. So you lose one there. Plus, blue side gets first pick. And the detriment of blue side is usually that you're going to have to show everything first. But because of the flexible picks for G2, they usually get to hide even further. First instance, Gragas, S-tier jungler, but also a support. Mickey has used it very effectively with Perks' Yasuo.
And you're already thinking about Gragas-Yasuo duo. If you think about tier lists, Ryze-Kai'Sa is kind of the obvious duo available to FBX. But what's the support going to be to deal with Gragas-Yasuo? Because post level 6, what a terror that is on the bot side.
And ding ding, Ryze-Kai'Sa locked in for FUM plus Phoenix. Do you are you bold enough to run the Yasuo down 0-1 in a series if you put yourself in G2's shoes?
I think for sure, because if you're going down the list of supports, there's nothing that's really going to deter you. As long as you can focus with your jungler to help control the minion wave for the Yasuo Gragas early on, maybe you're most worried about some tanky melee supports to counter it.
Got the confirmation on the Gragas Yasuo somewhere. When we were beatboxing about this, we came up with Galio support as maybe a premier support to try to deal and threaten a double melee lane. The Akali that's been permabanned for quite a while this tournament going to be locked in somewhere for G2.
And this is why we're highlighting the importance of side selection for this matchup. Because things are going to have to get through the draft because of these guaranteed bans, now Akali, one of the most feared flex picks on one of the teams with the most feared solo laners.
And you have three flex picks already for G2. They can still pivot this draft in any direction, but FUN plus Phoenix Phase 2 bans will give us an indication of the direction that they believe it's going to go.
And from the G2 side, I wonder, do you ban Kayle? Because it is a pick that Doinbeast by the doesn't fit in with his Ryze and Nautilus Hard CC duo, and Ryze-Kai'Sa has been the premier dive bomb duo. Gets the maximum value out of that Kayle ultimate. Because it doesn't fit with the way FBX usually play, you could understand G2 just giving it over to be selected.
Yeah, and it would be a fairly AP heavy for the team as well. We don't want to have, you know, too coordinated of the damage profile. Olaf is the first ban here for FBX. I like that they continue to focus on the jungle. In the last game, it was very, very big difference here with Lee Sin. We saw Tien roaming around, trying to get that extra second to set up plays. And now they throw two more attack damage jungler bans. This is what I mentioned in the champion select for game number one, taking these away, trying to force G2 onto an AP jungler, thereby maybe forcing a little bit of a shift of that Yasuo and bringing it back to a solo lane.
And they do actually, G2, ban away the Kayle, the GP, the normal blind pick here for Gimgoons, trying to put Gimgoon away from the sort of comfort he usually prospers in. So it's a very different draft. Consider game one, they left open all of the calling cards of FBX looking for that mental edge, those draft bucks that we've talked about. This game, it's very different as there's an old comfort for Doink.
Is it going to be the
Kayle?
It is locked in. During the press conference, he said, if they are brave enough to leave it open, I will crush G2 with the cleanse.
And what was so cool to watch from them in the last game is the execution on these force plays. It's one thing to draft these types of champions and be able to set up and try and go for picks, but the execution on those tower dives is so clean. Now again, as we mentioned last time though, Kled being dismounted is another facilitator of possible early game plays, early tower dives, and you have to keep your eyes out.
Okay, so let's turn our attention to the last pivots here. Tristana as well as Elise. I would anticipate this to be a Caps Tristana if it's going to be running into the Ryze and trying to match that. What do you make on that, Kobe?
I definitely agree. High priority on solo lane Tristana because we saw last time around, so much of the game is determined by being able to open up roams for your parts. Usually, people are used to one variable, the jungler roaming around. But both of these teams try and introduce more variables into League of Legends. And Tristana is one of those champions that can mine turret plates if you leave her alone, or push a wave with explosive shot very quickly.
Honestly, Kobe, when I'm watching a G2 blue side draft, sometimes my eyes glaze over till 20 seconds because I'm thinking about the infinite possibilities of that further swap again and again. Seems like FBX have come to a similar conclusion that we did in terms of support against what they assume is the Gragas Yasuo, the Galio support to try to actually just threaten that top. If you get brush control, it's hard for Gragas Yasuo to walk up.
Exceptional read on the draft, gentlemen. Now let's zoom out and look at these 5v5s, maybe from the G2 lens first, because I think FBX is a little more simple to understand, albeit it's Gimgoon running the Cleared, which made me a little sad.
Definitely the historians over here want to see the 9-2 mid lane Cleared, but it hasn't been a pick he's gone to this year, and Gimgoon had been showing in solo queue. So I guess there's no huge surprise there. We get this Akali versus Cleared top lane matchup.
Yeah, also Cleared a little bit more trouble in mid lane, seeing that it's a Tristana. It's very difficult to deal with that range discrepancy because Cleared gets a lot of value in matchups from going all in and using the vicious strikes, but Tristana always has either rocket jump or Buster Shot to get out of that. So given the last lock-in, I like the flex here.
Pick Your Poison has kind of been one of the cost calls you said the most times. You still end up with Tristana versus Ryze, which has been considered a Ryze counterpick in Worlds 2019.
Yeah, especially when we do cast our minds back to that Faker performance that you gentlemen have already talked about. Man, on your screen, Caps and Doin B. It is 0-1 for G2 Esports and FPX, the number one seed from the LPL. The defending title region is looking to make it a second world championship in a row. Very interestingly, in that previous game, despite the dominance these two teams have showed all summer long, it was the second longest game for each of them at the World Championship. Look at the minimap, and shenanigans are afoot. Both teams are grouped up, both teams are invading. And it's Gimgoon that takes the first auto, while FPX are grouped in the bottom quadrant.
See if they can actually get that deep ward down. Looks like they're fighting over the Raptor pit here. They're gonna see if it is a Teon red side start. And once again, with the level one, trying to discern if they can isolate this matchup.
That FBX bot lane invade, if they can actually make this a bot side controlled, would actually be another thing that would force Yasuo Gragas onto the back foot as the ranged opponent. Notice they actually didn't put down any vision when they went down into the red side jungle. It's very much just scouting with their faces and then backing away. Vision is much later, spotting the alcove there around the entrance to the red side of G2.
Let's see how Perks and Mickey play this duo. It's been an interesting discussion, the Yasuo Gragas play, because they were able to shut it down so effectively, even the quarterfinals, but then weren't able to demonstrate a mastery against SKT. So with both sides of the coin being shown, which one will we see today?
Well, I like that. What you expect is often not the case with either of these teams. Both of these teams like to attack where your opponent thinks that you are weak. Trying to use that element of surprise will often turn the tables. Usually, early on, Gragas and Yasuo can get pushed under tower because of the range disadvantage and because Yasuo doesn't yet have access to the E, only the Q trying to scrounge up CS here. It makes it a completely different game once Yasuo gets the E, is able to go for possible all-ins, and they can commit to those.
Speaking of all-ins, so walking up there. Level 2 ping doesn't come in. So Galio with brush control is what he alluded to in draft. You're seeing how difficult it is to interact. Tian's actually level 2 mid.
All right, Rune Prison does connect. Sonic Wave just short. You can hear the chants here from Paris. Top and mid was pushing towards FPX in favor of G2, but obviously this Gragas Yasuo is being bullied back.
In case you're wondering at home, very non-standard gank time to be mid lane as a red side Lee Sin at 2 minutes 30. You're not going to be level 3. You don't have the ward hop shenanigans available. It's a bit of a mind game there, but no inroads for FPX.
And because of the early invade, they're aware that G2 knows that Tian start on the top side, so they're not giving a tremendous amount of extra information away, and they both want to make their way down towards Gragas Yasuo. Tian, though, does not catch sight of Jankos.
Number of pings there from the FPX side into the bottom tri-bush. Jankos with flash available to him, Caps at level 3. Sitting in position, either waiting for a repeat gank or just shadowing that lane. Now all of a sudden he'll grab the Scuttle Crab.
And that's a key idea right there, a quick shot. Yanko's just looking for the move from Tian, a possible counter gank there, because he's protecting the pushing Tristana.
Spotted with the plant. This does mean that Gragas Yasuo will have a bit more swagger in the bot lane to take aggressive trades. The Hail of Blades tech was debuted at this Worlds. Does allow you to get much more impactful trades early. Caps actually just rocket jumps onto the minions to get the push.
Exactly. As we're talking about, the push in mid lane so incredibly impactful. Now we'll see how that actually trails into the rest of the game here. Kali, Wonder actually goes back in.
Well, a really fun trade between the two of them. Wonder and Gimgun have had, they were actually battling extensively in the Gangplank versus Ryze matchup in game number one, and they've already started with some heavy trades. Tian makes his way down bot, but he doesn't look like he's going to go for any plays just yet.
And the recall that we just saw in mid lane actually incredibly important, because that was Doenbi trying to get the first recall off to get the purchase on the early tier. He can start stacking this mana. He shoves the wave now, and we have to play around these 30-second windows. A new minion wave will spawn every 30 seconds. If you're able to push it in, force your mid laner opponent to actually handle that homework, then you get to make an offensive play.
And I want to make it clear, there's an extra variable here to talk about this Tristana Elise duo when it comes to ganking mid lane. It's the Ignite being run by Caps. Already these Elise duos have been the talk of this tournament, Elise and Renekton, for example. We already knew that Tristana is strong in this matchup. You add the Ignite and the Elise jungle against any opponent, and basically as Doenbi, you're pushing out one minion wave and then back.
And I think it's so important to note that right now, while Wonder is under trouble, Skull gets actually procced. This time round, Jankos is looking for opportunities. Contrast that to game one, where Doenbi on the Nautilus and Tian on the Lee Sin were able to get early advantages and many of them in the top lane. Jankos is looking for a play. The Justice Punch will find a tag there onto Perks, and LWX continues to step forward with that Akathian Rain. They end up winning the trade in the bottom lane.
Meanwhile, we're already seeing this Akali start to pull ahead on the top side of the map. Wonder, when he's afforded isolation there with the Akali, landing so many more of the last hits despite Gimgun going for these trades.
All right, the exhaust was thrown down there onto LWX, so summoner spell disadvantage for the G2 bottom lane, and Tian is now waiting in the wings. Level 5 for Doenbi. It's the flash exhaust on that Ryze, and I'm waiting to see the safeguard Sonic Wave Rune Prison combo. There is enough damage if they want it.
And I think Tian is mostly there for counter gank because we already alluded to how much threat there is. Starts to walk up and clear a ward.
All right, I want to look into the future because we don't want to get behind the game here.
Wait, you can do that?
Yes, I'll pull out my Scrying Orb.
Ooh.
With FPX actually having multiple people on bottom side, I expect G2 to try and play off of a level 6 power spike from Akali. I just mentioned Wonder's doing a very good job in lane. Akali is so good at executing the second part of her R ultimate and getting the kill onto Kled, because whenever you dismount, the extra percentage damage there does help you finish off tower dives, and you have an Elise on your team. So we'll see if they can actually afford to focus that lane with an Infernal Drake alive.
Notice, though, that Gimgun didn't use his teleport, so they can actually have 5 members here, FPX. And Akali can't join.
Not just yet. The Scuttle Crab was picked up there by Jankos. The Elise was able to secure that final hit. 10 creeps up. Note as well, Wonder nearly double the CS of Gimgun. Both of them at level 6. And Mickey and Perks making their way to ultimates as well.
That Scuttle Crab was an incredibly efficient smite from Jankos. Necessary defense now that they've acquired this vision. And bottom lane pushing up. Perks has been able to start the dragon. Yasuo very good at helping take these dragons because of the wind wall and allowing possible denial of skill shots from the opponent team.
This multi-step process, in spite of the losing 2v2 early, is going to get them an Inferno. It looks like Chris Facechecks gets the bad news. Tiana, don't be late here.
Well, they are going to be a little bit. 800 HP on the Inferno. Caps will just avoid that
overload. Oh.
That's a flash forward into the taunt. Dragon secured by G2, but the first fight is on the board. First blood again to FPX. Now Tian is going so low. Jankos repels up, comes down, gets killed. It's a jungler for jungler trade. And now Perks is blown up. 3-1, but the dragon goes to G2.
I believe Jankos didn't even have smite when they're starting up this dragon. That's why they're waiting around it for so long, too. In the end, he gets it with the execute Q form of Elise. But FPX with the extra killer going to try and push on bottom and earn some turret plate money.
And the instinct to walk up there actually gets them much more fruit than you'd expect. 3 kills for that first Infernal Drake secure. LWX gets a plate as well. That's a big early gold injection for FPX.
All right, let's take another look at it, because for G2 here, Jankos just used the smite on the Scuttle Crab for the vision, but because Chris flashes in there, forces up extra vision, they are under attack very early on. Tian eventually gets focused here as they get into the back of the Dragon Pit, but it is still 2-for-1, allowing then some map pressure for FPX, resulting in what you just saw. Now Kai'Sa with the gold bounty, 2 kills to his name for LWX and the CS lead.
But it was really a matter of time in this meta with your fast, decisive decisions required. And what we saw in that was the no smite and Tian lasting so long in the fight that ended up with the 3-for-1 trade.
And those are 2 trades right there. Later, power of Inferno buff, but Luklu, you can see on the gold total right now, LWX, far and away the richest person in the game.
1,300 gold above perks right now. His lane opponent, 15 CS lead. Obviously, you can see 201 in the kills, compliments of that dragon fight. And FPX again, strike first in the game, get themselves an advantage. And we need to see how G2 will bounce back. And also, how FPX are going to push this lead, because with a enabled Kai'Sa, maybe a little earlier than anticipated, Cleared, Ryze, Galio, Kai'Sa, that is a terrifying death ball dive style comp. As Kim Goon's gonna chase forward using the charge, and he almost gets the solo kill. Skarl gets popped. How did Wonder survive? He manages to stay alive a few seconds longer and gets under the tower.
And it was only just an inch away from being a straight up solo kill. Kled always does more damage than you expect in the 1v1.
Kled able to force out the flash there from Wonder. Now let's see if there's going to be any sort of response. We just have 2 resets on the side of FPX, so I think everything should calm down.
The gold standard here for FPX is to use that extra gold to get deep vision on the red side jungle to stop Yasuo or Gragas doing what it says on the tin, which is after level 6, doesn't matter how much gold Kai'Sa has, you can't walk up at threat of the body slam flash or the ultimate coming in. So actually expressing the lead in the 2v2 is actually difficult against specifically Gragas, Yasuo, or Duo.
All right, Kim Goon with the Hex Drinker here, going to afford him more opportunities to go for those all-ins onto Akali. With Press the Attack, you have a lot of burst damage that you can try and threaten very early. It's going to be about how these junglers work around the Rift Herald. Yankos leashes it all the way towards mid lane. That should give up his position.
Absolutely the case. Tian,
he knows.
He'll get spotted out. Sonic Wave finds a target. Repel app finds a minion to go down. Rune Prison locks him down. That's a buster shot on the Rocket Chump with the Ignite coming in. Crisp comes down with the ultimate. They end up trading.
Long cooldown used from Crisp there to no inroad. Mickey's mid lane going to be spotted on this, but you start to see the burst potential. Didn't really feel like Chitana put too much oomph into the autos, and yet Lee Sin almost went down.
A lot of damage potential when G2 gets the time to set it up, if they want to use the Tristana combination, but then you add the burst combination for the Akali as well as the Yasuo. There are tools for them available. Mickey sneaks away a little bit more damage on the mid-outer turret. And look at the minimap now. LWX and Crisp, they've recalled. They've put themselves in the top lane, and it looks like we're going to have Australia lane set up.
Yeah, and there's a very big difference here. Because of the extra teleport on Wonder, G2 can actually force a Rift Herald play. After swapping over, Kim Goon is basically relegated to bottom lane, especially until the Kled ultimate comes up.
But it's bottom lane with a TP disadvantage. FPX fantastic at using their teleports for offensive moves. Sometimes these teams walk up and fight too much. For now, Tian is going to be in disengaged view. They want to buy about 1.5 minutes for Kim Goon to be able to back on the map.
All right, Yanko showing bottom. Actually going to hover behind Wonder rather than go for the big play on top side with numbers advantage. And Tian, I think he gets it.
Yeah, he manages to sneak that one away. Crisp goes for the Justice Punch forward and will not find a taunt onto Mickey, but look at the minimap. Yankos has made his way up, and now FPX, they've positioned themselves to start the Heralds.
Yeah, you can see, whenever Kim Goon hovers in the river here, he's threatening possible Kled roam.
Perks wants the solo, and he will get out the Killer Instinct. He doesn't find the knockup. The exhaust was committed for that. Now, there's no Killer Instinct from LWX, and that final breath from Perks as Yasuo is available. The Herald is secured, and that solo attempt prevents G2 from picking a further fight.
Crucially, there's no TP ward here for Akali to come in, so despite having TP, it's not felt. The Rift Herald goes down. Perks is lingering on the top side.
G2 will get themselves a Cloud Drake, and the taunt finds two! FPX step forward. The Wind Wall and the Gragas Barrel does so much to work.
The
tower. Mickey goes down. Tien's not done yet. He gets all the way forward. FPX are looking for the first tower.
This is a tale of two pushes. Quick shot. Top side. FPX strike quick and they strike hard. Meanwhile, mid lane, G2 trying to fight back. They get a counter punch and the Tristana explosive shot will do some work.
And maybe the Tristana can be the difference, but otherwise FPX win all tails up in this fight. This time they have the Rift Herald on their first push and plenty of backup for LWX.
FPX continue to strike first here, mining more and more money. Let's see if there's a counterattack. As you can see on the minimap, Mickey and Perks move up to try and take down the Rift Herald before the charge gets off, but the damage has been done.
It absolutely is. No Gragas ulti available. LWX will flash away from Mickey's flash. It's traded one for one. Here comes Perks, here comes Caps. Doom and B's the target. Gets caught up on the final breath, but the hero's entrance does so much to save him. FPX cannot be stopped, cannot be contained, cannot be controlled, and they've got a 4,000 gold lead.
There's no way to back up through that hero's entrance, and the zone control of the Galio means that Yasuo is food for FPX.
FPX looks so clean right now, executing no hesitation on the re-engage. After they see Mickey burn the flash, they know they can just turn and burn. Root is used, and no member for FPX actually losing out.
And my eyes are fully dilated because it's a two-item build. Manimmune into the Rage Bait already done. Coming back onto this bait was a nice disengage. Doimby just about gets enough damage down and finished off by LWX.
And that's LWX accruing another kill. Kai'Sa now with four kills. As you talked about, Papa Smithy, the build is well underway.
I have been here before, gentlemen. Watching a European team playing a Chinese team where hope was high and gameplay did not live up to it.
Yeah,
it is a
let's hope it changes this time.
1,000 gold difference. Now, one thing that is important to note, G2 Esports did win consecutive team fights behind in gold versus SKT just 1 week away. I mean, they need to channel that performance again to bring it back this game.
Well, Cookshot, they're about to be posed a very difficult question. Gimgoon split pushing on the Kled on top side of your map. We're about to reach that top tower, but G2 continually looking for a possible aggressive move instead.
The silver lining is that the cooldowns are much longer on FPX's side, so you actually have to not lick your wounds. You have to re-engage before Hero's entrance and also the charge are off cooldown. For now, though, they're showing respect. Caps continues to get plenty of gold in the side lane, but they lose mid-outer.
It ends up being a mid-outer for bottom lane trade. Perks sidesteps some of the damage. Mickey gets caught up by the Kai'Sa W, and the Windwall is doing some work to reduce the follow-up damage. FPX, 2 towers to 1. They are behind in the Dragon game, but that is it. They have everything else on lockdown, and a super strong AD carry, 4-0-2. LWX has been consistent all worlds long.
And the team consistently drafts these compositions that allow him lots of room to work with. The idea behind FPX's strategy here, you have the Kled charging in with the extra speed, then Galio ult on top of the Kled to actually protect the remount there. And this opens up so many plasma targets that LWX is afforded a very offensive ultimate.
And it's just threat and zone control for him to just free hit and choose his moment. And yes, open the tournament ulting too much. Just speaking of ults.
All right, Realm Warp comes down. Void Seeker will connect onto Cap, but LWX decides not to go into the Killer Instinct. There was enough distance put between G2 and FPX before expending any additional ultimates. Doombi goes fishing. He doesn't find anything right now. It'll just be a matter of time before he throws down that Realm Warp. He's sitting 1-0-4. The front man for Fun Plus Phoenix. And he'll need to get a little more creative to put some pressure. But look at the minimap. Gingoon, he's pushing on that outer turret. And I think he'll get some chip damage before Wonder rocks up.
Still a lot of pressure here being applied by FPX. Stopwatch on this back coming through from LWX to go for one of those overeager dives. And yeah, it was the first day where suddenly we were down on FPX, that first seed from China that just wasn't able to pull the trigger smartly in the first round robin of the group stage. But they've been building since then in this first seed versus first seed battle.
And I really like that people sometimes forget that these players are very, very new to this big of a stage. On the world stage, all of them showing up now under pressure. And that is very heartening to see.
All right, there's the engage, the kickback. Mickey finds some damage on Dewey Bean, but he's instantly thrown to the wolves. The charge from Gingoon brings some damage backwards, but goes gold, and LWX stays alive. Windwall buys some time, but simply not enough. Perks goes forward. The final breath does nothing. thing. And it's Crisp that gets another. Two quick kills to FPX.
And look what they can do with that quick shot. They get free reign over the map. The dragon should be in the hands of LWX and the rest of FPX. G2, they have to back up and retreat to their towers now. There's nothing left for them to defend.
It's very much an every man for themselves when someone gets picked so quickly to open a fight, and there are more re-engage options available for FPX. We're mercifully before 20 minutes. There's no Baron Punish open for FPX. Here is the replay. So much lingering doubt in the fog, and very quickly, Mickey got the bad news.
Tian is so good. Everyone highlights Duan-Vi because of the champions that he uses. But remember, Tian was also added to FPX to start off their remarkable rise. He's able to get the kickback to start this whole play. And then, as you're talking about, the chase down there, Papa Smithy.
I'm a big fan of LWX leading with his face. He says, I don't care if I'm a four kill Kai'Sa, I'll frontline. I've got the stopwatch. I didn't build this to save.
Oh, I love that leading with his face.
Oftentimes, when as soon as you buy the stopwatch, you're like, I'm going to be pretty rich soon. I'll turn it into Zhonya soon. I need to get the active usage now.
Exceptional lead here for FPX. 5,000 gold just before 20 minutes. And despite the fact that a recall's coming in from Crisp, G2 Esports have no idea. Look at what they have to deal with. 106, 2.5 items completed for Duan-Vi. 2.5 plus that broken stopwatch for LWX at 4-0-5. And it feels like every time G2 have looked for an opportunity, their response has been equal or better from FPX.
And while FPX are super far ahead, 5,000 gold pre-20 will tell you that, the final tipping point is Baron. If FPX get Baron, this G2 comp doesn't have anywhere near the right amount of wave clear close the game. But it's going to start it and take the fight if G2 come in.
Take a look at the minimap. Akali and Tristana are nowhere nearby. They were not invited to the Baron party. Now Mickey can get a multi-man knockup, which Perks can follow up on, but they're too late. They're too slow. And FPX, they get the Baron. They realm warp forward, and now Perks is the target. He gets a small knockup, forced to flash defensively. While that's going on, Wonders pushing the bottom lane. FPX extend the gold lead even further. They are looking at the inner turret, and Kim Goon is able to reply. FPX don't even lose a bottom outer turret.
This LPL train's not stopping anytime soon, Quickshot. They'll got the Baron empowered recalls off for the reset and head straight back for more.
The Chinese freight train was one of the big memes of season 3 and season 4. And it's
You're
rolling.
Taking me back.
It's rolling. Well, it's, you know, history lessons abound. We're trying not to think about 1 year ago today, effectively in the last World Final. But FPX look impervious to G2 strategies. They've called out and they've dealt with this Yasuo Gragas duo that so many other teams have rolled under the strength and pressure of. And suddenly, it really feels like G2 have one more roll of the dice, and even then, these are loaded dice to FPX.
Absolutely are, especially with one additional little quick stat.
I'm listening.
That was the fastest Baron of Worlds 2019, set by Fun Plus Phoenix. This was always going to be a crazy final. And we've just hit a small pause. As soon as I hear why, I will let you guys know. But FPX are in such a commanding position this game.
It's the face cams of the G2 players that I think will be the most interesting, because you're going to be wearing the anguish on your faces. I was a big fan of their strategy in game number one, of really going for a dangerous game, and look, got answered, went down 1-0. G2 have the grit to come back from the corner of the plank, let's say. They have come back from 0-2 down multiple times, and you can certainly count on the Paris crowd to try to help them rebound.
Yeah, help or hinder. That amount of noise, that amount of pressure. We are finding it hard to focus at times. I can only imagine. But look, everybody watching at home, 32,000 to 40,000 gold at 21.5 minutes. There's Baron on the side of FPX. And look at those players on the G2 side. That is not happy and smiley players. They feel the pressure that they are under. And since quarters and semifinals, no team that lost game one has been able to win the best of five.
No League of Legends players will have greater pressure on them than those in the World Championship on home soil, Quickshot.
Yep. It's G2 G2 that really has transferred that pressure, not to themselves, but to all the European teams coming over to the LEC, picking the brain of the pros and the coaches. They said G2 winning MSI meant they could no longer go to Worlds and go as far as they could. They couldn't be happy with just a playoffs best of five. They felt pressure to make it to the final and to win the final. And here are G2, and they're starting to feel the same pressure they created for their region.
Can I take a moment to once again quote the press conference?
I'm listening.
As Paris is cheering and screaming, Warhorse, the coach for FunPlus Phoenix, was asked a question about, will the noise, the cheers, the scale of this stadium be different for the players, and how will they handle the pressure? He laughed, physically laughed, before saying, I've looked at G2's win-loss internationally. I've looked at ours. They are the ones that should be worried. And as it stands, FPX have come out the gates and they have just delivered in every game.
Well, Trevor, now is the time where veterans need to step up. Veterans need to shine. Because when you are under pressure like this, especially when you get towards those late game team calls, you have to have the calm voice. You have to the focus be brought back under the magnifying glass to keep your eyes on the prize.
I'm gonna call out Warhorse. The sample size is pretty different between the history of games that G2 have played and the history of international games FBX has played. I'll take his point. I know what he's trying to say, but there's some sample size issues there.
And of course, you have to step back and think a little bit about two finals in a row, EU versus China, LEC versus LPL, 2 years in a row where hope is high for the European representatives. But when the pressure is turned to max, fail to deliver. I love the sign, raise your baguettes for G2 Esports. You need to raise a lot more. Give them your energy if you want us to see more games this series.
And if you want to talk stats, there, of course, has been much discussion about this on Reddit, the fact that FBX so far have dodged Korean and North American teams. You look at G2, they played 2 games against Chinese teams this year. Scheduling worked out that way. They lost both to IG, and we never got that big best of five between those two teams. So regionally, this is definitely a bit of a bogey team for G2.
I think there is no doubt that right now LPL is the strongest region. If you look back over the last 2 years, 3 of the 4 big Riot International victories came from the LPL. Let's take another look at that Dragon because it was so exciting. No Smite for Jankos. He does get it with the execution with his Spider Form Q. And the thing that's traded over is more gold and a favorable map state for FBX. Because they get the 2 kills, not only do they get that extra immediate value, but they were also able to get the turret plate off of bottom and push heavier.
And you just see the value of a Galio in both these plays. In the first play, get the Gragas Yasuo level 5, so they don't have any zone control. In this play, Yasuo goes in, the Galio's there to cut off the rest, and that's why exit kills were possible for FBX.
Crisp has been so incredibly good for FBX, setting up a lot of these plays. Tien has been so incredibly good setting up so many of these plays. In back-to-back replays, we see each of these two facilitator players being highlighted.
And then as the play tail-ended here, there's not really any passengers on this team. You know, Kim Goon has been really good in his role of not getting a lot of help in most games, game one an exception, and still flourishing, has some very nice sidesteps on the GP, for example. So with no passengers, you start to reap the rewards as the pause does draw.
It does indeed. And as an update, League officials have received reports by FunPlus Phoenix during the last team fight, as League officials have reviewed the Shadowplay footage to verify some of the lag that was reported and resolve the issue. Let's send it over to the analyst desk.
Thank you very much. Quick shot while we wait for League officials to sort that out on stage with the teams. Gives us a moment here in what looks like dire straits for G2 to start breaking down this game too and what might be the rest of the series here.
I mean, frankly, it's starting to look like a 3-0 at this point. Like, yes, there's still a lot of game to play, but I really do feel that if G2 just get absolutely smashed here, FPX are proving, like, we came into this and we were like, oh, you know, G2 have the individual better players. Today, FPX far exceed G2 in individual powers. Mickey especially is just getting schooled by Crisp.
I think also that's a huge thing in the draft, 2 games in a row now, where execution required from G2 to actually pull it off is much, much higher than what it is from FPX. If you look at this one especially, first picking the Gragas into them, playing your Gragas Yasuo, which we have seen so many times from them, it does make it a bit harder to play the game because you don't have the traditional AD carry just sitting there. They traded that for the Kai'Sa pick that we knew was going to get locked in by FPX. And I think that's a bit of a problem because G2, they've been so used to outplaying mechanically in these skirmishes. They're not doing that against FPX. They're matching them or beating them.
And I want to point out what's happened in the first two drafts in terms of bot lane champions. Because coming into this, we had one checkmark for Perks and one checkmark for Crisp. But what's ended up happening in the draft phase is G2 have been tested on the AD carry champion pool, and FPX has won both 2v2. So the very first time Zion Rakan are gone, you immediately think Varus Tahm Kench is now the highest priority. So G2 just jump on it. However, Sivir Thresh split the lane, which means they beat it because Sivir has a better late game. So that's one example. This game, we see it again. First pickup, Zaya banned, do you lock Kai'Sa? That is almost an instant lock for any other matchup so far at the World Championship. But G2 think Kench Varus beats it. So they instead go Gragas Yasuo, say if you pick Kai'Sa, we will beat it with Gragas Yasuo, but then they don't. So now they're two games in a row kind of losing that draft test in the bottom lane, and it makes it very difficult for them to draft their way out of it.
And one of the signatures of G2 taking this Yasuo Gragas is splitting the map, just like what we saw in game number one when FPX did it. Usually, when they have Yasuo Gragas, G2 like to do that. So they can start to set up some dives, and they can start to set up this Yasuo and Gragas to just be a terror down there. But they didn't. And I'd have to go back and review kind of what happened or if it was just G2 making that decision. But what is normally a very aggressive, very forward lane around the level two is when you start having that kill threat. I don't know what happened. I'd have to go back and see, did Chris zone them off a wave? Did they take some really bad early trades? But something went wrong down there where now G2 in what should be a comfort bottom lane is playing from a very far back foot.
All right, well, with that, I've received word that the players are ready checking and heading back into game in just a moment. So we're going to toss it right back up to those three handsome gentlemen for the call.
Thank you very much, and we are right back into game. Tian will throw out the Sonic Wave just to catch you up. FPX have smashed this early game. LWX and Doing B, recipient of so many kills and assists, and obviously with the Baron, are now doing some work. Crisp gets caught out by the ultimate. Tian puts so much damage on the Yankos and is turning around. Crisp throws down the stopwatch, we're right back into the heat of it. Here come FPX over the wall. Hero's entrance into the river, and G2, they cannot find anything yet. They're chasing on Crisp. They've got themselves. Finally, one more kill. But the teleport comes up from Kim Goon. He doesn't have the charge available. All of a sudden, Mickey's down.
Oh!
Oh, two, three. LWX can find the triple. Tian gets another. G2 are aced at 22 minutes.
And FPX will march down mid lane. Baron Buff in tow. They will lay waste to these towers.
They laid waste to the enemies there. LWX is so damn fed on this Kai'Sa. They'll barrel through, and because it's early, they might not be able to close purely because the death timers are short.
It's a 10,000 gold lead already, and look at the members of G2 Esports faces on the player cams. They are grinning manically, sadistically, because they are understanding the situation they are in. G2 Esports have their backs pushed against the wall. There is no more room for any mistakes or any dream of coming back this game.
However, you also have to increase your acceptance of risk and go for the opportunities that are presented to you, Quickshot. Take your chance because you're so far behind, you need to make it work. That's why they're smiling here. They know they have to throw a big punch, and they attempt to attack FPX while they're split. This moment where LWX has a great dodge with the Kai'Sa Killer Instinct, but Crisp already used the Galio ultimate, was almost an opening. They were able to get the Galio kill, but it bought time for FPX to collapse, and FPX do not let them get away.
And of course, that replay brought to you by Axe Gaming. What's your move? What's your move, Tian? Setting up LWX. It ends up being a trade of one for one. Yankos escapes a few seconds longer, but the bear trap on a rope will not pull him backwards. Now Caps, he steps forward, trying to get Skarl to run for the hills. Rocket jumps once again. Not gonna find him just yet. I think that Realm Warp was interrupted. I think the Cocoon did it. Now Perks is looking for a last breath target. Yankos escapes for now, and Perks gets blown up where he stands. Caps Krabs will not be able to kill Gimgoon. He goes golden. The stopwatch saves him this time. Now Caps is in trouble. He gets chased down, run down. Not yet killed by DLWX, but it will only be a few seconds longer. Yankos rappels up, drops down. Chris continues to chase him. Goes golden. The stopwatch buys again so much time. But here comes Doin B. He gets the kill. LWX cannot fight Caps, but Gimgoon may be able to. Blast Cone is available, and so will the Rocket Jump. Oh, Caps! He runs into Tian, and he will finally get taken down. 17 kills to 3. It's not done yet, Kobe, because Mickey's chasing Chris.
Action still going here. Quick shot. Root lands for Ryze.
Yes, screw it. Here comes Wonder. Pick another fight. Why the hell not? Flash over the wall. Killer Instinct to kill Wonder. Now, Perks has rejoined the fight. He's going to get taken down by Doin B. He gets the knockup. He can't even breathe one last time. Nor can I. At a 13,000 gold deficit, FPX are pushing the base.
They're pushing the limits of your large lungs over there. The Yakety Sax music reverberating around the Accor Hotel Arena. This should be the close for FPX.
FPX are one win away from a world championship title. They turn their attention to one last kill. The Nexus goes down and FPX are 2-0 up. We are on the cusp of deja vu coming true once again. The beginnings of a potential LPL dynasty. Two world championships back to back. That is what FPX is staring down right now with a potential clean 3-0, which we haven't seen since play-ins.
And it's incredible that this is one of the newer teams from the LPL. The rise of this Phoenix has been meteoric, Quick Shot. With adding Doin B and Tian, them coming together, coming from a bottom half LPL team, skyrocketing to the very peak of competition.
And it's pretty arguable that Doin B was the best player to never make it to the World Championships before he qualified for his first. And now he might be a world champion the first go. Ambition was the last person we talked about with that metric. Took him two goes. So this is already a royal road of its own.
It's unbelievable looking at the impact that Tien is having. The fact that even when Gimgoon was in pressure game one, like got support game one, had pressure this game, it doesn't matter. Every single individual is showing up. Kobe, you were saying that all five players are doing what they need to do to get FPX ahead.
And I love the style of League of Legends that we're seeing, what it has evolved into, because not only does it require you to be mechanically proficient, it also requires you to be very, very quick with your decision-making. Both of these teams, as they get further behind, they're going to take riskier and riskier plays. They don't stop forcing. And so the one ahead has to keep answering and keep making those
come true. Again.
And of course, in the next game, we'll get an opportunity to talk about G2 Esports and why they are down 0-2. FUN plus Phoenix are a game away from claiming the Summoner's Cup. Let's find out if G2 can put a stop to the Phoenix's flight right after this.
Welcome to Assist of the Week, presented by State Farm. Nearing the end of Game 1 in the G2 vs. SKT semifinals, SKT was ready to strike the final blow. After gaining vision around Baron, SKT started the objective, ready to turn on G2 Esports if they steered too close. SKT spotted a solid 5v4 engagement and Effort dove in with a Hex Flash over the wall. However, a speedy retreat from G2 Esports and two well-timed stopwatches from Yankos and Wonder threw SKT into disarray. Faker found himself too deep with the rest of the team trying to follow up, and G2 Esports plucked off SKT one by one. G2 Esports rushed down the lanes, realm warping to SKT's Nexus, setting the pace for game one of the series.
The new Oppo Reno 2. Quad camera. Zoom into imagination.
So you want to go get that coffee then?
Yeah.
Whoa. Ow. So you want to go get that coffee then?
Yeah, just going to take my headphones off and
we're good.
Let's go.
Legends never die when the world is calling you. Can you hear them screaming out your name? Legends never die, they become a part of you. Every time you